unite us with Christ and with each other, in suffering and in joy, that all the world may be drawn into your presence, through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. You may be seated for the reading of Scripture.
God is king over the nations. God sits screen in Luke right here is the very ending of the book of Luke. And as you can hear, they tell similar stories. They're a hinge, is what we're taught. A hinge between the work of Jesus in the world in the book of Luke and the work of the disciples in the world in the book of Acts. And then Jesus said to them, "These are my words that I spoke to you while I was still with you, that everything written about me in the law of Moses and the prophets and the Psalms, they must be fulfilled." And then Jesus opened your mind to understand the scriptures. And he said to him, "Thus it is written that the Messiah is to suffer and arise from the dead, and on the third day, and that repentance and forgiveness of sins is to be proclaimed in his name to all nations, beginning from Jerusalem. So you are witnesses to these things. And see, I am sending upon you what my Father promised. So stay here in the city of Jerusalem until you have been clothed with power from on high." And then he led him out as far as Bethany, and lifting up his hands, he blessed them. And while he was blessing them, he withdrew from them, and he was carried up into heaven. And they worshipped him. And they returned to Jerusalem with great joy, and they were continuing in the temple, blessing them. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
You may be seated. So, Jesus ascends to heaven, and now flesh is part of the Godhead. Jesus ascends to heaven now, flesh with this part of the Godhead. Whatever you think of God, whatever you think God is made of, whoever you think God is, a part of that is flesh.
Kind of tricky to think about, get our heads around.
So, John Calvin, who was a contemporary of Martin Luther, a medieval reformer, he said that the flesh of the Son in the Holy Throne Room was a distraction, a holy distraction for our Father. A holy distraction. And what he meant by that, as he explained,
is that when the Father looks upon us on Judgment Day in our broken down flesh, he will be distracted by the love that he has for the Son in his flesh. And that distraction will bring us grace and mercy.
Think about this. If you remember the second creation story in Genesis, that after Adam is booted out of the paradise, Jesus or God puts a door up and guards that door so that Adam can't get back in paradise. And now the new Adam has knocked that door down. Jesus has pried that door in paradise open and has taken a spot next to the Father in the Holy Throne. And he's left the door askew so that it seems like the very contents of heaven leak out at times. Last Sunday at Easter, let's go all the way back to the first Sunday at Easter, Sundays ago. If you remember, at Easter Sunday morning, of course you remember because I preached the sermon and it was enlightening and powerful for you. And on that first Sunday morning, we read that one of the disciples of Jesus, a woman named Mary, runs into Jesus after the resurrection, and Jesus tells him not to touch me until I ascend.
Right? Kind of an odd thing to say. You thought at the time.
And then a week later, Jesus, in the same book of John, runs into another disciple, a guy named Thomas, and he encourages Thomas to touch him. So we are left to believe that in that week, Jesus must have ascended and come back. Now, by the
like ascension isn't a once and done sort of thing. It feels like once those doors of heaven have been broken open and left askew, that Jesus kind of leaks out at times. God's presence comes, forms in Jesus. So when those two men clothed in white robes that Sally told you about in that text today, when they say to them, "Don't worry, he'll be coming back," we think we hear on Judgment Day, at the end of time, somewhere way out there, but who knows? They could have just met tomorrow or the next day. It's hard to tell with Jesus. So in my first church, I had this old farmer came to see me. And he had been grieving. He had lived his entire life with his mother. And his very elderly mother passed away. It was terribly hard for him. And he came to see me, though, not to share his grief, but to share what had happened the day before. That evening, he had been pottering in his workshop. And he turned around. And he said, there was Jesus in the workshop with him. Pastor, I know it sounds crazy. And I'm not crazy. You know that this guy's an old narrow farmer. I mean, I'm not crazy. And there was Jesus. Not us, but him. And he said my name. And I felt at peace for the first time since Mother's Day. And he told me to be all right. Even though I've heard that from 1,000 people, I really believe it might come right now. Jesus leaped from heaven into our presence. Jesus ascends into heaven, and our flesh sits in the very throne room of God, the Father, and the Son, unless he's left for a bit. Maybe to show up on a beach and eat fish with Peter. Or maybe to show up in a locked room and encourage the faith of Thomas. Or maybe to show up along a road and set Paul on a different path. Or maybe to show up in a workshop for a grieving elderly farmer. Jesus shows up at times. Who would not want to lift up a prayer of Jesus, show up for me in my workshop, in my office, in my bedroom, startling me in the middle of the night? Jesus, show up for me. I had a friend stop me because she just wanted to vent. No particular thing she wanted to talk about, but just wanted to vent about the pains and the burdens that had just been building up in her life. Real stuff. You know, I mean, pains and burdens are kind of like bricks, aren't they? I mean, they kind of build a wall in front of us. And if we can't knock a few down or get rid of a few, before you know it, we can feel overwhelmed by all of them in front of us. And she's just in that point where she was feeling a little overwhelmed, where this wall was so tall, and she couldn't even see the sun. And in the midst of the study, she went into this holy, rhythmic sort of song. I just want Jesus to appear. I want to touch the cloak of Jesus like that lady did in Scripture and make it all go away. I just want to have my tears dry up. I just want to be healed of Jesus. There is not a person in this room today that hasn't come to worship without somewhere, some brick that is building up. It's advocating to many, or is maybe lonely. 6 week layoff notices, it is coming fast. Come, Jesus. The hole in our heart that nothing can fill except the one we miss. Come, Jesus. who's chronically ill. Come, Jesus. The overwhelming nature of having financial debt. Come, Jesus. Alcohol, drugs, sex, video games, nothing can stop us from feeling the feelings that we don't want to feel any longer. Come, Jesus, from heaven, and make this go away. That's our prayer. And for some, it might happen. They might be startled by the presence of Jesus in a workshop or in an office or at the foot of their bed. But for most of us, it won't. So those disciples, as they're watching Jesus ascend with their mouths open, they were all in. I'm sure they were going to stay there for the rest of their lives. They weren't going anywhere until Jesus came back. And the two men in white robes had to tell them, get out of here. And go pray that what Jesus promised would happen. Because that'll be even more powerful than Jesus coming back. Because before Jesus left, if you heard in the story, if you read throughout all the four Gospels and in the book of Acts, before Jesus left, he promised that he would leave something even more powerful than his presence 24/7 in front of him. Hard to imagine. That's what he said. And that more powerful thing was going to be the very love that is shared between the Father and the Son. And that by the power of the love shared between the Father and the Son, which we call the Holy Spirit, by the power of that Spirit, it would be able to do even greater works, Jesus says at one time. It would be even better by having Jesus be himself right there. That the heaven and doors that are left open not only allow Jesus from time to time to come among us, like they did for that old farmer, but it leaks out a drenching rain of the Holy Spirit that covers us. We may be startled by the presence of Jesus one day in our lives, but we have the promise of living in the community of the love of Jesus all of our lives. So after my friend went through her whole event and we got to the end, Jesus didn't come. He wasn't there. It was just me. Like it. And I couldn't make her tears stop, and I couldn't take all those burdens away. All I could do, filled with the Spirit, was hand her to wipe away those tears. All I could do, filled with the Spirit, is listen as she shared those burdens. All I could do, filled with the Spirit, take half of one way over here and try to make that my priorities. And you wonder how that feels better than Jesus showing up. I think the way it feels better is that I'm not the only one that are here at Holy Night. He lives in the body of Christ. And so others, filled with the Spirit, will listen and wipe tears and share burdens. And others, filled with the Spirit, will listen and wipe tears and share burdens. And so that together, brothers and sisters, filled with the Spirit, we can be made whole. Even that old farmer, after he visited with me, after that remarkable and wonderful body of Christ, surrounded by people filled with the Spirit. We can't make each other's problems go away. Unless, of course, we are our neighbor's problems, and then we could probably make that go away. But beyond that, we can't. But what we can do is we can be Christ for each other, filled by the Spirit, committed to lightening each other's burdens, committed to wiping away each other's tears, committed to listening to each other's fears, committed most of all to forgiving each other's failings, so that filled by grace, the abundant grace of love that is between the Father and Son, we can be the presence of Jesus for one another. The power of that number must be better. So Jesus ascends into heaven, pries open those doors and leaves them askew, and now not only the flesh of Jesus comes down time from time to be among us, leaped out of the open doors. But maybe more importantly, not truly more importantly, from those fried open doors, there is a pounding rain of love from the Holy Spirit that drenches us when we live our baptized lives together here in the church. And that is how we will be made whole while we breathe our last on this earth. Amen.
come with us to this space. We give thanks for the presence of Jesus that is in the midst of us by the power of your Holy Spirit. And we pray for the courage as a congregation, the patience as a congregation, the grace and mercy as a congregation, to love each other as the Spirit empowers us to. Lord, in your mercy. Holy God, we pray on this Memorial Day weekend, giving thanks for those who have given their lives for our country. We pray that their sacrifice be not wasted by pettiness, ugliness, partisanship. And Lord, most of all, we pray that their sacrifice might never be needed again. Bring peace to our world, Lord. Lord, in your mercy. Holy God, we pray for those who are lost, alone, heavy burdens today in this space. May they find a spirit-filled person to listen to them, wipe their tears, pray with them, and share their prayers. Lord, in your mercy. Father God, we pray for all those who are sick and ill. The long list in our bulletin board. Heroes, people's pleas. We pray for all of their caregivers, too. And we lift up Deb, Meg, Lois. I don't have the list in front of me. I'll trust you here. And we say other names aloud now. Lord, in your mercy. All this we pray, and whatever else your wisdom needs and we need, we pray by the very confidence of the Son who is saved. Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you all.
Thank you.
the breaking of the bread, as you were made known to the disciples, receive these gifts and the offering of our lives, that we may be your risen body in the world. Amen.
Thank you.
Now may the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in God's grace. Life-giving God, in the mystery of Christ's death and resurrection, you send light to conquer darkness, water to give new life, and the bread of heaven to nourish your people. Send us forth as witnesses to Christ's resurrection, that we may show your glory to all the world through the same Jesus Christ, our risen Lord. Amen. A few announcements today. We have the Vacation Bible School is the last week of June, and so registrations are available out in the Welcome Center. You can grab one of those and put them in our robot, so if you know any kids who need to sign up, make sure you are spreading the word. But also, we usually take in donations to help us with getting what we need for the program. So out in the Welcome Center are also poster boards where you can grab one of the gears. That's kind of part of the theme of the week. So you can grab those, and a donation list is on each of them. They're kind of grouped in various ways. So you can grab one, grab two, whatever you like, and help us with getting things together for our program. Also out in the Welcome Center, it's possible to still sign up for Kroger rewards, where a portion of that goes to us, to Messiah. There's a donation from Kroger. And so if you shop at Kroger, you can sign up out there. And I also hear that you get put into a raffle. We're giving away a prize this year. So head out to the local center and sign up for that. And then finally, you can also sign up for lectern, reading scripture at the 11 o'clock service. If you've never tried it, try it out. See how you like it. Use your speaking voice and sign up to share the scripture and serve in the service in that way. And also, because it's Memorial Day weekend, we wanted to also take this opportunity to recognize our veterans. So if you are a veteran, would you please stand so that we can acknowledge and thank you. Lord, make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you. is our last.